Hello students, welcome to my channel Agricultural Engineering Online with continuation of video lecture series on farm power. In this video lecture, we will discuss on hydraulic system basics for three-point linkage and hydraulic power transmission. Hydraulic is one of the drive systems to control machinery and equipment comparable to pneumatic and electricity. Generally, hydraulic system transfers power by feeding a hydraulic fluid from a closed vessel with variable displacement to another closed vessel. Generally the principle in this case is pressure is the basis of the hydraulic power. It is generally explained in accordance with Pascal's law. Pascal's law is based on certain characteristic of fluid, that is, pressure works on a plane at a right angle. Pressure is transmitted equally in all directions, and pressure applied in a part of the fluid is transmitted throughout the fluid equally. Basically, this is the principle in fluid mechanics. Pressure changes occurring anywhere in the confined incompressible fluid is transmitted throughout the fluid, such that the same change occurs everywhere. So if you see, there are two pistons are there. So one is small piston having the area A1 and another piston led it, the big piston having area A2, and there is a liquid closed vessel is there, and force applied at one end with piston area A1 is multiplied force at the piston area A2. Generally the force whatever is can be generated at the other end is based on the force multiplier. For example, the pressure is constant everywhere in the vessel or the liquid, by the liquid. Therefore, the force per unit area is a pressure at the small piston, that is area A1, will be equal to the pressure at the other end, that is F2 by A2. From there, if force F1 is applied at the small piston end, that the area, according to the area, the force F2 is can be generated with a multiplication of A2 by A1 area with F1. Therefore, this is called the force multiplier. So it is similar to the you can say balance by having the arm length, that is F1 and F2 both end, and having the length, according to the length you can apply the arm movement. So this principle will be used throughout this hydraulic system. Coming to the components of hydraulic system, the circuit comprises of hydraulic pump, with the symbol is like this. We'll discuss later on what are the different type of pumps. Pressure relief valves, which releases the pressure, extra pressure, or it sets the pressure of the hydraulic system. Directional control valve, which directs the liquid into different cylinders of the system. Flow control valves, which controls the flow, regulates the flow, discharge, and velocity of the piston in the cylinder. Hydraulic cylinder is the most important part, which fluctuates due to the pressure of the liquid inside the cylinder, and which lifts the load or retracts the load. So these are the systems, pipes and other things are there, as well as accumulators are there to conserve some of the energy, which will be used when extra energy or pressure is needed in the system. And filters are there, which filters the foreign particles from the hydraulic fluid, so that it cannot damage the pipes, the directional control valves, pump and other things. So therefore, these are the basic components of the hydraulic system. Next is the hydraulic pump. Hydraulic pumps is the most important part, which drives the fluid into the hydraulic system with a pressure, working pressure. So basically the hydraulic pump is the soul of the hydraulic system. So it comprises of piston, different type of pump. Basically three type of pumps are there in the system. Piston pump operates on the expansion and compression of volume in a cylinder block with the piston stroke. It generally it's having the efficiency is very high. The valve plates is easily damaged, you can see here, and it's highly susceptible to foreign substances in oil. The suctionability is very low, and it's easy to convert the variable displacement by changing the angle of the swath plate or bent axis. Generally, the size is very large, heavy, and expensive. So this is a piston pump. Mostly, it's a positive displacement pump, which is used in the hydraulic system mostly. Next, vane pump, which operates on the principle of expansion and compression of volumes between the vanes and the cam ring. So you can see there are number of vanes are there and cam rings are there. A discharge port is there and another port is there. So cam ring and vanes, they contribute to the pressure build up by the vane pump. So generally its efficiency is low. It can be compensated when the vane wears out. It's susceptible to foreign substances, therefore filter is very important. The suctionability is little higher than the piston pump, and it can be converted. The variable displacement can be changed by changing the eccentricity of the cam ring for the unbalanced type. So its size is small and relatively inexpensive. Coming to a gear pump, mostly the movement of volume is between tooth spaces and the casing. So basically this is called the external gear pump. The efficiency is little low and it drops as the gear wears out, worn out. It's susceptible to foreign substances again, but suctionability is little higher, more than the other two. And but variable displacement cannot be done in this case. Its size is small, so widely used. This pump is generally widely used in the system, hydraulic system. So these are different types of pumps generally used in the hydraulic system. Next, coming to the relief valve. A relief valve, or pressure relief valve you can say, is a type of safety valve used to control or limit the pressure in the system. Pressure might otherwise build up and create a process upset, instrument or equipment failure or fire. The pressure is relieved by allowing the pressurized fluid to flow from an auxiliary passage out of the system. The relief valve is designed or set to open at a predetermined set pressure to protect pressure vessel and other equipment from being subjected to pressure that exceeds the design limits. When the set pressure is exceeded, the relief valve becomes the path of least resistance as the valve is forced open and the portion of the fluid is diverted through the auxiliary route. So just like here, you can see there are auxiliary route is there. So when the pressure is higher, it just vents out. So this is called the direct operated, and also it is pilot operated. Here actually the movement of the valve seat actually happens due to the small pilot port is there, which actually force the valve seat to change its place so that the high pressure liquid is venting out from the discharge port. So this is called the vent connection or pilot operated relief valves. Coming to sequence control valves, there are times when two or more actuators operating in a parallel circuit must move in sequence. The only positive way to do this is with separate direction control valves and limit switches or limit valves. This setup assures the first actuator has reached a specific location before the next operation commences. If there is no safety concerns or possibility of product damage, if the first actuator does not complete the cycle before the second starts, a sequence valve can be a simple way to control the actuator actions. So this is the sequence control valves generally used. And there is counterbalance valve. Normally closed pressure control valves is generally used for the hydraulic circuits as a counterbalance valve. But cylinders with external forces such as weight from the machine members or tooling acts against it, them will overrun when cycled if oil flowing out of them is not restricted. A meter outflow control circuit is one way to control overrunning loads, but it has a main drawback. There is flow control speed is fixed except for manual adjustment. When using an infinitely variable proportional type, because flow is fixed, the actuator will continue at the same speed even when working fluid to increase or decreases. So this is counterbalance valve, specially to reduce the fluctuation. Next, coming to the directional control valves, they are the most important part or most fundamental part of the hydraulic machinery. pneumatic machinery. They allow fluid flow into different paths from one or more sources. They usually consist of a spool inside a cylinder which is mechanically or electrically controlled. Directional control valves can be classified on the number of on the basis of number of ports, two ports where it has two ports to open or close a hydraulic line, three ports where it is three ports for changeover from the pump port to two ports on two ways only, and four ports where it is four ports for a wide variety of purposes, including moving the actuator forward and backward or stopping it. Or multiple ports, generally they are used for special purposes to direct the fluid into different cylinders. On the basis of number of positions, it can be classified as two position where actually one is forward and one is backward, and it can be three positions where there is a center to open or closed system will be there, and multiple positions where it is generally used for special purposes. So coming to the open center valve, what is open center directional valve? Open center is refers to open central path of the control valve. When valve is in neutral position, the hydraulic pump is continuous flows. When valve is neutral, then hydraulic fluid goes back to the reservoir, or T for the tank in this case. As we move valve, let us extending the actuator side, hydraulic path disconnects in valve from return and connects to the actuator extends side, and the actuator moves. Similarly, when we move valve to retract side, hydraulic path in valve connects to the retract side of actuator. In such system, multiple valves can be connected in series, but one reservoir is operated at a time. This is very simple system and uses less expensive pumps. And in closed system, the control valve does not connect to the reservoir return in neutral position. Instead, pump offloads by varying its flow rate. Generally, variable displacement type of pumps are used here in this case. Valves are placed in parallel and multiple service can be operated at a time. This system is used in modern machinery or equipment for high performance. Coming to the manually operated DCV, it is generally operated manually by a hand lever to have different positions of the directional control valve. The symbol is, it has three positions, 1, 2, 3, neutral is there in between to hold the machinery in the perfect position, or it is pilot operated, where actually there is a pilot port will be there, where a pressurized liquid less than 0.5 megapascal is directed to the pilot port, and due to that pressure, the directional control valve is generally operated. So the symbol is like this. So here actually there is a certain small pilot Y is there. Coming to the flow control valves, a check valve that is also called as non-return valve or retention valve or one-way valve is a valve which normally allows fluid or liquid to flow through it in only one direction. Check valves are two-port valves, you can say, meaning they have two openings in the body, one for fluid to enter and another to exit the fluid. And coming to the restrictor valve is a valve that restricts the flow of fluid in either direction. It is normally used to slow down the speeds of jacks, etc., also called as a flow restrictor. The symbol is like this. And coming to the flow control valves, so flow control valve generally controls the rate of flow of a fluid through a hydraulic circuit. Flow control valves accurately limit the fluid volume rate from fixed displacement pump to or from branch circuits. Their function is to provide velocity control of linear actuators or speed control of rotary actuators. Typical application includes regulating cutting tool speeds, spindle speeds, surface grinder speeds, and the travel rate of vertically supported loads moved upward or downward. Flow control valves also allows one fixed displacement pump to supply two or more branch circuits at different flow rates on a priority basis. Typically, fixed displacement pumps are sized to supply maximum system volume flow rate demands. So this is the symbol of the flow control valves. Coming to the cylinders, basically the cylinder is the most important part of the hydraulic circuit, where it actually generates the load to use according to our requirement. So coming to the classification of cylinders, it will be either single acting cylinder or double acting cylinder. In single acting cylinder, it is a cylinder in which the working fluid acts on one side of the piston only. A single acting cylinder relies on the load, springs or other cylinders to push the piston back in the other direction. So it is a piston, cylinder and ram, which is up or down, it moves. So and also it is only one port which is supplied by the hydraulic fluid, and the symbol is like this, either without spring or if with spring to retract it due to the spring force, then it will be called as the symbol will be like having a spring. Coming to the double acting cylinder, a double acting cylinder is a cylinder in which the working fluid acts alternately on both sides of the piston. Many hydraulic and pneumatic cylinders use them where it is needed to produce a force in both directions. A double acting hydraulic cylinder is a port at each end supplied with hydraulic fluid for both the retraction and extension of the piston. A double acting cylinder is used where an external force is not available to retract the piston, or it can be used where high force is required in both directions of the travel. So it is also a piston, cylinder and ram, and which is having a sealing component to seal the fluid so that it does not come out. It is two ports, one is inlet port and another is outlet port or supply port and return port. So whenever it is required to reverse the flow from one direction to another direction. And the symbol is like this, having two ports compared to the single acting cylinder. Coming to the filters, it is also most one of the important part where it prevents the foreign particles or materials to pass through the other parts so that it cannot clog or damage the parts. And also it has some accumulator which accumulates the energy whenever it is not required. So when it is offloaded or something like that, but when more pressure or instantaneous pressure is required, it supplies the pressure. Therefore, it's called the, it is having, it is generally works on the universal gas law, and it is compressive gas or liquid. So which when there is more pressure, it is compressed, and when there is less pressure, it supplies the back pressure to the system. Coming to the hydraulic circuit neutral position, where actually the pump supplies the liquid. Pump might work or might not work, but the cylinder is not moving due to, or fluid is not going into the cylinder through the inlet port or outlet port. So therefore, it's the directional control valve is in neutral position or the center position, you can see here, and the liquid is coming to the tank or reservoir. Coming to the extend stroke or forward stroke, what happens? The pump supplies the pressurized liquid to the directional control valve. So therefore, the directional control valve is open, and the liquid goes to the cylinder to one side of the piston, and it tries to, due to the pressure and area, the force is applied on the ram, then the ram moves, therefore the load is lifted or taken out. So this is the, and the other side of the piston, so the liquid moves out from the cylinder to the reservoir through the directional control valve. So the directional control valve is there, so one position is there, so one is in to the cylinder and another is out to the tank. So therefore this is called the extend position of the directional control valve. And there is a pressure relief valve is not working here, and it is set at a certain pressure. Coming to the next, hold. So whenever some cylinder is working and the piston moves, it has certain load and it has to hold that load. Therefore, the position again in the directional control valve will be the middle position, where it is the no liquid is coming out or to the cylinder. Therefore, the position is maintained, it's called the hold position, you can say, and either the pump might work or might not work. So when the pump is working, the liquid will go through the open center or closed center. If it's open center, generally the liquid will go through the middle position of the direction control valve to the tank. Or if it's a fixed displacement pump, if it is a variable displacement pump, then it will be, the displacement will be varied. So this is the holding position, where actually the pressure relief valve might work or might not work. Next, coming to the retract stroke again. So here actually the reverse of the port is done, so that the liquid, the pressurized liquid is going to the other side of the piston, comparing to the forward stroke, and it goes, the ram is moving just in retract position or return position, and the liquid from the other side of the cylinder, that is the piston side, comes out through the other port to the tank. So here you can see the third position is maintained instead of 1, 2 or 3. So other position or cross position is maintained. So this is called the retract stroke. Here actually the liquid is coming to the tank through the other port. So here you can see one thing, that is directional valve or check-in valve is here. It is working because when the pressure is going one way, it can go through the check-in valve, but other way it could not come. So generally it is restricted to the other position. So therefore it's the load is maintained in this case. Coming to the open center, so you can see already we discussed the open center is the, you can see here. So in open center valve, the center of the direction control valve is open, so that the liquid comes to the tank or reservoir. Therefore here actually the pump might be fixed displacement type, or it's working continuously. But in closed center, you can see here the liquid is the pump, from the pump is not going through the center of the direction control valve. Therefore it is just either bypassed through the pressure relief valve, or the it is a variable displacement type pump, where actually the displacement is varied according to a requirement or offloaded. Next is the piston speed calculation. So let us just calculate the speed of the piston when there is extension stroke or retraction stroke. So when it one side of the piston is having greater area than the other side of the piston, due to, because there is a ram is there, so ram is having certain diameter, small diameter. Therefore the liquid, the area, since the load is dependent on the area according to the Pascal's law, we will calculate how much speed when there is a extension stroke the piston moves, and how much speed the retraction stroke is there when the piston moves. So let us calculate with having the same pump discharge. Let us first of all, this piston has a different cell area of both sides. Let us, D is the diameter of the piston, so this is one side where, and the larger side, and small d is the diameter of the ram or piston rod, you can say. Then from this we can calculate the area of both sides. So the, so this side the area will be that is full area, that is A1, let it be pi by 4 d square, d is that diameter of the piston, and other side the area will be small because of the minus area of the that piston rod. So therefore the area will be pi by 4 d square minus d square, that small d is the diameter of the piston. So on the basis of this area, we can calculate the speed if the discharge to the cylinder is same, that is QCI, that is the discharge to the cylinder inlet, you can say. And if that is QCI, then we can say V1 is the speed during the extension stroke. We can calculate the speed as velocity into area is equal to discharge. So discharge is same, therefore the velocity can be calculated using the formula, that is Q by area. In this case the area on the lower side, that is the full area, the V1 will be equal to Q by pi by 4 d square. Coming to the retraction stroke, that is the back stroke, the reverse will be there. So that means the liquid will going to the other side. So therefore the small area is in working condition. Therefore the velocity, that is V2, during the return stroke, and same discharge, that is QCI is there. So therefore the velocity will be equal to Q or discharge divided by area. Area is pi by 4 d square minus d square, small area. So this is the velocity. So now we can calculate the velocity ratio between the extension stroke and retraction stroke. That will be pi by 4 d square minus d square. There is a small area by large area. So therefore in the forward stroke, the velocity will be less than the retraction stroke. Next, coming to the load capacity. So load capacity also is determined by the pressure and also the diameter or area of the piston. So here also the differential area is here, A1 and A2, both side different area will be there. Therefore pressure remaining the same, that means the let it the pressure developed by the pump is PO, there is a pump output pressure, and same between the some losses will be there, and finally some pressure is given to the piston through the cylinder. It is the PCI, the pressure input to the piston. In the one side or lower side where the pressure area is later more, it is A1, so then and pressure is PCI. So since the load it can carry will be equal to there is F1, which will be equal to the pressure into area. There is PCI is the pressure and area is pi by 4 d square in the case of extension stroke. This is the maximum you can say load it can carry if you neglect all the losses. If losses will be there, that is the we'll discuss later, then it will be little less, but maximum it will be the this one. And during the retraction stroke, let us see the load capacity will be how much. So that also depends on the area. Therefore the during the return stroke later, the F2 is the load carrying capacity or pulling capacity you can say, and the pressure is same as the previous case. During the extension stroke let it PCI, therefore the load will be equal to F2 will be equal to PCI into pi by 4 d square minus d square. So here the area is small, therefore the load carrying capacity will be small. Therefore the load ratio between the extension stroke and retraction stroke will be equal to F1 by F2 will be equal to d square minus the difference in capital D square minus small d square. So this is the load carrying capacity ratio. Coming to the power efficiency of the pump, let us discuss in detail. So let us start from the pump. First is, let us see the pump is generating some first is motor, pump is operated by the motor. So there is the power source to the motor. Let it the speed of the pump is same as the speed of the motor. So therefore NP is the rotational speed of the pump, NP or motor in RPM, and DP is the displacement, pump displacement you can say per revolution, per is meter cube per revolution. So meter cube is the cubic meter is the pump displacement per revolution of the pump. And from there we can calculate the theoretical pump discharge. If there is no loss, then it will be QP, that is NP by DP by 60. So very simple, because the revolution is there by 60, it is second, it will be meter cube per second is the unit. It is the theoretical pump discharge. And but due to certain loss in the volumetric loss, you can say in the pump the discharge will be little less. That is the QPO is the pump output discharge. So pump volumetric efficiency is output divided input, or theoretically you can say that means the volumetric efficiency of pump will be equal to you can say NVP in this case. So NVP will be equal to QPO by QP in this case. So QPO can be calculated from there, that let it QPO will be equal to QP into NVP, and also it is called the percentage of slip of occurs in the pump. That is called the percent slip. It can be calculated by using the formula, that is QP, that is the input discharge to the pump, that is theoretical discharge you can say, minus the actual discharge, that is the pump output discharge divided by QP. There is also you can calculate the percent slip. Sometimes it asks, so how much slip is there in the pump, or that is also related to the volumetric efficiency. Little difference is there, otherwise, or you can say one minus volumetric efficiency is called the slip. Now coming to the shaft input power to the pump, let it SPP, which can be calculated by using the formula 2 pi NP TP by 60 in watt, where NP is the pump rotational speed in RPM, which is the same as the motor speed, and TP is the torque from the motor to the pump. And let us see the pressure output from the pump, let it PPO, And torque efficiency on the basis of pump pressure output can be calculated by using a formula, that is QP or QPY in this case. There is a pump input or displacement, theoretical pump discharge QP, QPY into the pump output pressure divided by SPP, because there are some losses in also there in the pump. So taking that one, the torque efficiency or the torque efficiency will be of the pump will be calculated by using this formula, where actually QPI is equal to DPNP by 60. Here already this one, there is QPI or QP divided 60 into PPO is the pump output pressure into divided by SPP. SPP is 2 pi NTP by 60. So putting these values, we can calculate the torque efficiency of the pump will be equal to DP into pump pressure output divided by 2 pi TP. TP is the torque required to the pump, or we can say the overall pump efficiency, or that will be multiplication of volumetric pump efficiency into torque efficiency of the pump. You can multiply, so you can calculate that one. Coming to the pressures, so let us see the del PC is the pressure drop in the cylinder. That pressure actually drives the power. How much power it generates depending on the pressure drop in the cylinder, let it del PC. And del PC dash or its let it pressure lost in cylinder. So some pressure is lost in the cylinder. From there actually you can calculate the torque efficiency of the cylinder. And let us say some pressure is also lost due to the pressure pipes or valves or any other thing. So in the system or the hydraulic circuit, some loss will be there. Let it del PL dash. That is the line loss. And this is the pressure output from the pump, it's PPO. So finally both all are different. And if you say there is total pressure generated by the pump will be equal to, there is the pump, there is the pressure drop at the cylinder plus pressure loss at the cylinder plus pressure loss in all the systems or line, all the lines, that is del PL. The maximum load capacity of the cylinder is based on the maximum pressure drop in the cylinder, that is del PC. Therefore, the piston area into the del PC, there is the pressure drop divided cylinder efficiency. If you see cylinder efficiency is certain thing, which due to that some loss will be there. So therefore, the del PC will be equal to the pressure input related to the cylinder is PCI, that is the, that is after deducting the pump output pressure minus del PL, then it will be PCI. PCI minus the pump output, that is cylinder output pressure related to PCO. Generally it is zero, but some of the cases some pressure is there also, back pressure you can say, to hold it proper way. If there are certain valves are there, then some pressure will be developed here actually. That is called the PCO. So therefore, the load carrying capacity will be less. The load carrying capacity will be PCI minus PCO minus some losses in the cylinder. In most cases, the cylinder output pressure is zero. Coming to the hydraulic system, transmission system, you can say in hydraulic system to transmit power from engine to machine component is called the hydraulic transmission system. The main components of hydraulic transmission system is hydraulic pump and hydraulic motor. Other than other things are same is the hydraulic circuit already we discussed. Therefore, hydraulic pump is the positive displacement pump, gear pump generally used, which converts rotary motion of the engine or mechanical energy of the engine to pressurized energy of the hydraulic fluid. And hydraulic motor are similar to the hydraulic pump, but it converts pressure energy or of the hydraulic fluid to rotary motion or mechanical energy required in the machine components that are located remotely from the engine. So therefore, hydraulic transmission also system also plays an important role to transmit the power to a remote location where actually the machine parts or shafts cannot reach. Coming to the open loop hydrostatic transmission, that is the mechanical power or engine power or source that should be transmitted to the mechanical power output point or farm power output, where actually remote point you can say. Then there is pump is there and motor is there. That is the reversible same, but they are just opposite to each other. So pump symbol is this and motor is this one, just opposite you can see. So the direction is just opposite. It generates pressure and motor utilizes the pressure. So the pump is driven by the source, that is engine or mechanical power source, and motor drives the output source, you can say output point or shaft. It is, so both are same or just different, they are just opposite to each other. And let us see, SPP is the shaft power of the pump, and water power of the pump or output power from the pump is WPP, and QPO is the the discharge from the pump, and WPM is the input power to the motor, WPM, and QMI is the discharge input to the motor, and SPM is the that is the shaft power output, you can say, from the motor. And you can join by the hydraulic circuit. Other things are there, the valves and other things are there, we are not showing here. So just discuss about the different efficiency of the system, hydraulic system. So a reservoir is the tank which contains the liquid and which supplies the liquid to the pump, also the from the motor whatever the liquid comes to the reservoir. Coming to the efficiency or performance of the pump, let us see. DP is the pump displacement in revolution, that is meter cube per revolution. In this case, this pump is there, this P, and this is motor is M, and NP is the pump rotational speed, as already mentioned in the case of hydraulic circuit. The QPI is the pump input, that is our theoretical discharge from the pump will be equal to DPNP by 60 cubic meter per second. That is this, and BPO is the discharge output from the pump in meter cube per second, and NBP is the volumetric efficiency of pump in percent. Already we know the volumetric efficiency will be equal to pump output discharge divided by pump input discharge, that is QPO divided by pump input discharge is DPNP by 60. And let us see, del PP is the pressure drop across the pump, that is the loss in Newton per meter square or Pascal, and torque efficiency is TP, torque efficiency in percentage. Then you can calculate QPI into del PP by SPP. Del PP is the pressure actually, which is actually generated in this case, not drop actually in this case. So what is this? Is the pump output pressure, del PP. Then DPP, by just calculating this QPI is DPNP by 60 into del PP into 60 by same as previously already done, the pump efficiency, torque efficiency of the pump will be equal to DP del PP by 2 pi TP, and shaft power is 2 pi NP TP by 60, already it's used here. Then TP is that input torque to the pump, and water power or output power from the pump will be equal to QPO, that is the discharge output from the pump into the pressure generated by the pump, del PP in watt. So that is called the output power of water or water power from the pump. And overall efficiency of the pump will be equal to output power from the pump divided by shaft power. Very simple. Output by input, that is QPO into del PP, that is the pressure, total differential pressure it is generating, divided by shaft power. Or we can say overall efficiency of the pump will be equal to volumetric efficiency of pump into torque efficiency of the pump. Next, coming to the motor performance. So let us see, DM is the motor displacement per revolution in meter cube per revolution, and NM is the motor rotational speed in this case, or it is the output speed of the motor, and QMI is the discharge input to the motor, which is the same as the discharge output from the pump in meter cube per second, or we can be calculated as QMO. There's a motor output discharge is already we know according to the motor displacement per revolution into speed of the motor divided by 60 in meter per second. And let us see the volumetric efficiency of motor, let it be in percentage. that can be calculated as the output divided by input motor discharge. That is DMNM by 60 is the output motor discharge divided by QMI, which is the QPO from the pump. So therefore, let us see the pressure drop across the motor. It's del PM. So the pressure whatever is generated by the motor pump will be utilized by the motor to generate power in this case. So let us see that TM is the output torque from the motor, or the output power you can say, torque. That is SPM, same as the SPP, that is 2 pi NM TM by 60. This is the shaft power output from the motor, and torque efficiency of the motor will be equal to the shaft power divided by motor input power, or that is the output power you can say from the motor. It is del PM, the motor pressure drop, into QM is the motor output. This is the, which is equal to DM NM by 60, or theoretical motor discharge you can say. So from there we can calculate, that is 2 pi NM TM is the SPM, or shaft power from the motor, into DM in 60 by DM NM, because this is in the denominator. So therefore the torque efficiency of motor will be equal to 2 pi TM divided by DM into del PM. And also water power, or input power of, or water power from, or to the motor will be equal to QMI into del PM, which is supplied by the pump, whatever the power, that is the input power, water power. And overall efficiency of the motor can be calculated. That will be equal to shaft power output from the motor divided by water power of the, from the motor. That can be calculated as you can say 2 pi NMTM already calculated here, this one. And this is QMI del PM. So, and from there we can calculate the overall efficiency of motor will be equal to NVM, that is the volumetric efficiency of the motor, into torque efficiency of the motor. So this is the motor performance, where you can calculate, and overall transmission efficiency you can calculate the total efficiency, that is overall efficiency of motor, and multiply by overall efficiency of the pump, you can calculate the transmission efficiency of the hydraulic transmission system. So this is all about the basics of the hydraulics. Hope you understand. Please like and subscribe to my channel.